Of course, all of this agriculture and city building and civilization was happening in the Americas without anyone in Europe or Asia or Africa knowing anything about it. Although it's not true that everybody believed that the world was flat until Columbus came along, many people, including Columbus himself, were unclear about the actual size of the Earth and about the width of the Atlantic and the existence of the Pacific Ocean. As this reproduction of a 1474 Italian map shows, many Europeans thought that crossing the Atlantic might bring them to Cipangu, Japan, and to Cathay, China. And not all Europeans were unaware that there was something valuable across the Atlantic. It's important to realize that European exploration did not begin with Columbus. Around 1000 of the Common Era, almost 500 years before the Italian explorer set out to discover a new trade route to Asia for the Spanish king and queen, Norse explorers from Europe and from Iceland established a colony on Greenland. The Greenland colony lasted for centuries and was the base for exploration and settlement even further west. Leif Erikson, the son of the Greenland colony's leader, Erik the Red, set up a colony that the sagas call Vinland. For a long time, historians believed that the Scandinavian claims about a North American colony of Vinland were just patriotic folktales. But in the 60s, a site was found in northern Newfoundland. And in the 70s, archaeologists began accepting the idea that this settlement at a place called Lansalmedo on the northern tip of Newfoundland was more than just a fishing camp. The 8 buildings included a blacksmith shop and a spinning room that included artifacts used for spinning, wool, and weaving that suggests that women may have lived there and may have worked to clothe their families in this colony. This ended, we now believe, with the Little Ice Age, which wasn't an ice age, but was a period of global cooling that hit the North Atlantic particularly hard beginning around the 1430s. Sailing became increasingly dangerous, and the Greenland colony was actually abandoned in the early 1400s. And of course, without a base in Greenland, the Norse would have been unable to sustain a North American colony. The colonists also apparently faced strenuous opposition from natives that they called Skraelings, which in Old Norse, I believe, means that they screamed a lot when they went into battle, who, according to the sagas, were very, very fierce warriors. This map, made in Iceland in 1570, identifies the area at the latitude of Newfoundland as Skraelingaland. North of that is Markland, the land of forests, and then Helleland, the land of flat stones, and then Greenland. And on this more recent map of Greenland from 1747, you can see the names of the old Viking settlements, as well as a channel that it was believed had once cut through Greenland from one side to the other, about which the mapmaker wrote that it had existed, but it had now been filled with ice. History textbooks tend to stress the European desire for wealth, for gold and silver. And finding precious metals was a very important motivation for explorers like the conquistadors. But we also shouldn't underestimate Europeans' fear of famine, especially during the Little Ice Age. Even before Columbus's voyage, Basque and Portuguese fishermen were regularly visiting the Grand Banks off the coast of Newfoundland to catch cod. A 1497 account by Giovanni Caboto, another Italian explorer who anglicized his name to John Cabot because he was sailing for the English, Caboto claimed that cod populations on the coast of North America were so high that fishermen could almost walk from ship to ship on their backs. Salted cod is still a very important element of traditional Portuguese cuisine, although nowadays they get their fish from Norway. The fisheries were originally a closely guarded trade secret, but by the time Columbus made his famous journey, they were well known. And since cod is usually salted and dried on racks on shore before being carried back to Europe, Columbus and his crew were probably not the first Europeans to make landfall in the Americas. Columbus's promise to find a sea route to Asia interested Europeans like Ferdinand and Isabella because land-based routes to Asia were becoming more difficult and more expensive. The collapse of the Mongol Empire at the end of the 13th century and the plagues of the 14th century increased the perceived danger of overland travel. And the high prices charged for Eastern spices and silks at the markets of Cairo and Baghdad, which were controlled by the Ottomans, caused Europeans to look for a new direct route to the sources of these commodities. Columbus failed to interest Portugal in his proposal because Bartolomeo Dias had already discovered a route to Asia around the bottom of Africa. But Spain had just recently unified with the marriage of King Ferdinand of Aragon and Queen Isabella of Castile, and the married monarchs had just completed the Reconquista and ejected the Muslims from the Iberian Peninsula earlier in 1492. It is worth considering, I think, that as they began turning their interests outward and thinking about conquest and colonization, the Spanish had been at war for nearly 800 years. It's also worth noting that the inventions that sparked this new era of exploration and empire building, like the sternpost rudder and the compass and gunpowder and the printing press, were all Chinese inventions that had found their way to Europe over an already existing international trade network controlled by the Muslims that was about to become truly global with the discovery of the Western Hemisphere. Columbus arrived in the Caribbean on October 12th, 1492, and he explored until late December. His flagship and largest ship, the Santa Maria, ran aground on Hispaniola on December 25th and had to be abandoned. With permission of the local chief, Columbus left 39 sailors behind in a settlement that he named La Navidad. He returned to Europe with two ships, a few captive natives, some gold, and some specimens of native species, including turkeys and pineapple and tobacco. Arriving in Barcelona in mid-March, Columbus was celebrated as a hero. It's often mentioned that Columbus believed that he had reached Asia, and he did make a claim to that effect in his very extravagant letter on the first voyage. But this document was the explorer's report to his royal sponsors, and Columbus wanted very, very badly to be sent back again. Columbus also wrote, "Hispaniola is a miracle, both fertile and beautiful. The harbors are unbelievably good, and there are many wide rivers, the majority of which contain gold." Whether or not Columbus understood that he was reporting on previously unknown lands, he definitely got his readers excited about the places that he had visited. Now, before we continue, a couple more questions for discussion. First, why do you think historians tended to disbelieve stories of Viking settlement in Vinland until just recently? Secondly, why were Europeans so interested in sailing all the way across the Atlantic to fish for cod? Third, why were the Spanish monarchs interested in financing Columbus's voyage across the Atlantic, but the Portuguese not so much?